With that backgrounder, we set the tone for the discussion on the program. We're talking about multiple streams of income, and our guest on the show today is David Olalere Oyetunde, the Deputy Director, Finance and Accounts, National Automotive Design and Development Council. He's an economic and financial expert. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much.
You're wearing two very interesting caps, I must say.
Okay, so let's begin the conversation proper now. Talking about multiple streams of income, what are the benefits? We've seen the background there, so what are the benefits?
Well, the benefit is enormous because we need to know what do we mean by multiple streams of income. Then, as the name implies, it means an income that is not from only one source. There are several other sources by which you can earn income. And of course, it is believed that an average millionaire has 7 sources of income. And why do people need to have several sources of income? You know that situation may come where somebody has lost his job. There can be economic downturn. There can be health challenge. And if you depend on only one source of income, this may not be sufficient to take care of your needs. Of course, like in Nigeria, where the bills are rising almost on a daily basis, this puts unnecessary pressure on someone. If it is only on one source of income, it may be grossly inadequate and you will not be able to meet up. When you have multiple sources of income, of course, you have what we call financial freedom. You have less financial risk and you are in control. And if you develop it, you can go into so many other areas of investment.
Some people have been civil servants all their lives. That is, they've always been in paid employment. They never delved into business. Perhaps they're listening to you today and it sounds quite interesting. Everyone wants to have something for the rainy day. What areas can someone who has never delved into business before look at, for example, and what should we arm ourselves with so that we don't fall flat?
Well, thank you very much. You know, there are two types of stream of income. We have passive, we have active. Yeah. Active, it takes a lot of energy and time. And passive take less effort, less time. So if you are already engaged in an employment, definitely, they will take your time. They will take your effort. And usually, if you talk of civil servants, they are expected to spend minimum of 8 hours. So after 8 hours, what else can you do with your strength? Definitely, it will be little. So it is very, very very, very necessary for you to have multiple sources of income that is passive income. And when we mean passive income, you are talking of income that requires less effort, less time. And what are those areas by which you can engage in? There is what you call affiliate marketing. Affiliate marketing, today you can sign up to any of the businesses online. Then you sell their product and you get your commission. It doesn't require much effort. All you need to do, even when in the office you have some little time off, you sign up. You keep on doing something. That is one way. We have networking marketing. In networking marketing, is a which you get into a team online. And when you go into it, you discover that if you put some little effort and energy into it, you can become a leader. An area manager, and by then you continue. Of course, we have fleet marketing as well. In that case, there are so many of your used clothes, used shoes, used this, which you have on weekends. Carry them to where you can sell them, like Okrika Market. You make money.
Mr. Adetunji, you make it sound so easy. You know, a lot of people have complained that building multiple streams of income can be daunting, time-consuming, and expensive. Now, how can that be managed?
Well, thank you very much. It is not easy, I must tell you. Because if you want to have multiple streams of income, three key principles have to be adhered to.
Okay.
One, you must be hardworking. Hard work is there. It must be intentional. You must have intention to have it. And number three, you must be patient. So you need a lot of energy to put into it.
For example, many people have been duped. A lot of people have gotten into all this downline, upline, upstream, second income stream direction, and they've come out very disappointed. So two questions in one. How do you identify the businesses that will bring returns? How do you know forthright people? Then how do you prepare yourself? That is, how do you arm yourself with the knowledge? There must be some atom of requisite knowledge before you can perform creditably well.
Well, thank you very much. Yes, as you rightly pointed out, you don't jump into business. You need to carry out some investigation. You need to do some little research on the business. If you don't know, you can even attend some business classes where they open up your eyes on some other areas. You can understudy some people who are already into the business that you have interest in. So when you understudy them, they tell you some of the do's and don'ts, and then they tell you some of the problems that they are facing. Then you look inwards, what do you have? Because they will tell you what is the takeoff, capital that is required of that business. You need to know. And of course, in any business, even when they write feasibility report, I tell you, when they tell you it is 100 naira, get 300 naira down. Because there are some problems that cannot be foreseen as at the time they have written all those things. Of course, the environment keeps changing.
Yeah.
So technology keeps changing. So so you they may be writing based on the particular set of customers, but by the time you want to start, situation has changed. Customers have already known some other new things. If you don't incorporate, you'll be outdated and you will not be needed. So that is one area. Another area is that in most cases people enter into wrong hands when they are greedy. So because how can somebody tell you that if you put 1 million naira, you will get 1 billion naira? Is it feasible? You know, if it is, it happens like that. Why can't that person? Do you think the person loves you so much and is now bringing you to come and make money? So I don't think so.
Okay, so Mr. Adetunji, losses are sometimes inevitable. So when one records losses, you know, in terms of downturn in markets, what should an individual do? Is that enough to just deter one's spirit and say, okay, I'm not going into it again?
Yes, thank you very much. Losses are inevitable. But the point is that if you are the type who goes into evaluation on a regular basis, you can foresee when losses are about to happen.
Okay.
There are signals that you will see that things are about to happen, and we try to avert it. Of course, if you go into the principle, they will tell you that if you do a business, and that business, if it is within the short time, let's say in less than 2 years, you are engaged in a business, and the income you are getting cannot pay all your variable cost, then get out of that business. So if in the short run it can pay your variable cost, you continue. In the long run, it must pay both variable and fixed cost. If it cannot, you pull out.
That means if you're not recording profits, there's no point.
Whether you are recording profit or not, every business venture you go into has an objective.
Okay.
So if your objective is to render a particular service, is that service being rendered? Is it being appreciated? Is it as you desired? If it doesn't meet the target, there is a failure already.
But perhaps how long ought you to wait? You have your main job, then you invest in something, perhaps human capital or your personal resource. How long ought you to wait before you say, okay, this may not bring meet my expectations?
Well, every business has gestation, just like planting. When you plant maize, it's not the same time you will harvest when you plant yam, or you plant maybe coconut.
Sure.
It's not the same.
Sure.
So in the same way, in the businesses you are engaging in, they will tell you the gestation period, the time between which you start and the time you can be reaping the profit. So, and it varies from business to business. Just like people who have gone to higher institution, somebody goes for medical line. You cannot become a doctor until after 6 years. You go for internship, you go for this, maybe everything putting together will be going to 7 years. It's different from somebody who goes for accounting, which will spend 4 years. Because what is required for you to be a competent medical doctor is so much and enormous than what it is required to be an accountant. So in the same way in business, you need to find out from people who are already in it.
And also check some balances is also critical. So how can one keep record, track record of one's finances?
Well, that one is very key. Record keeping is very key. Because how do you have information as to the growth of the business is through your record.
Yes.
So you must have good financial record. These days, there is a Sage Accounting package and there are some other software. Like I am a Sage Accounting consultant. So if you keep it, you don't need to know so much about accounting. All you need to know is how do I make entry through the computer. Once that is done, it does all the necessary things for you. You go to the report format. And from there, you will see it. And you can see how you are moving. So if you are moving upward, you will see it. If you are moving downward, you will see it. If people are paying you, we see who are those who are paying you regularly, who are those who are not paying you regularly. If some people are paying you as at when due, then you can be granting them some little credit facilities.
Okay.
And that will boost your sales and you will make more money. Those who are not paying you well, you don't grant them credit facilities. So, but all this can happen if you have records. If you don't have records, how will you know? You will not know.
Is it too late to start for someone who hasn't started, who is not thinking about it? Is it too late to start?
It is never late.
Okay.
At any given time when you want to start a business. The problem with many of us in Nigeria is that people feel that when I start something, I should be the one to end it. No. When you talk of business, it has what we call life, in perpetuity. So it doesn't have an end. If you go overseas, you see that many people who started business, they give from generation to generation.
Yes. Yeah.
So if you look at Tata, they say his grandson that is the chairman of Tata Group. So the same thing with Toyota and some others. So this is the concept that we need to imbibe. If you start a business at whatever age, when it gets to retirement, you hand over to the next generation and they continue.
Some businesses, no matter how small, require some amount of capital. And at the time where to get capital is so difficult, there's so many prerequisites. And even it's almost like you need some kind of connection to liaise with banks. If your business requires some capital that you don't already own, are there easy avenues where you can get this resource?
Well, I have had that practical experience precisely in 1983. So all I did was that I look for people who have money, but they don't have business idea. I bring them on board. Then I explain the business to them. We started making money. So I did my first degree by sponsoring myself. So what I did was to go into business. And what do we do? Three of us, we join hands together. We buy cement. When it's due for disposal, we sell to those who have shops. They will sell. We just need little gain to keep going. So the position is that you can face it. In the real estate, like you can begin by buying land here and there. You go and buy depending on what you have. If you have little money, which means you cannot buy land within town. So you go inside bush, it will be cheaper. When you buy land there, you keep it, you discover that as development is growing, that land will be appreciating. If you have like 3+, you may discover that you sell 2, you use the 2 to build 1. By then you have a house and you start renting. And as you are renting, of course, you will keep on moving one by one and start doing.
Okay.
And that is one way. Another way is that you look for business that doesn't require much. Like if you go into website design, go into the, I design website and I develop website as well. And what I do? Within 3 months, I went into online and through the YouTube, I study how to design. And from there, I knew it and I started doing it.
Mr. Adetunji, that's for you. You started small and today you're reaping the results. So I want you to talk to Nigerians, people who are still stuck, people who don't see the benefits or the use, having multiple streams of income. What's your advice? We're about to round up.
Well, my big advice to them is that you cannot, have financial freedom. You cannot have control of your financial life if you depend only on one source of income. You just have to build streams of income. And what you do is that you build one first. When that one is running successfully, you add another one, you add another one, and that is how you have streams of income. And by the time you start having it, you have enough money to go into it.
Thank you so much, Mr. David Olalere Oyetunji. He's an economist and a financial expert, also Deputy Director of Finance and Account, National Automotive Design and Development Council. Thank you very much for sharing your perspective.
Thank you very much.
And this has been quite educative.
Thank you so much.
All right. We've been talking about multiple streams of income. Wouldn't it be great, you know, if you have that income coming into your account just when you need it and you don't have to worry about paying bills? So think out of the box. We'll go on a break. We'll be back for you on Weekend Deal.